champions for the third time ever. What a day.
When you talk about Offaly hurling over the past 15 years, there are really two success stories to tell. One concerns the winning of 9 Leinster titles and 3 All-Irelands in that period of time. The other centres on this town here, Barr, and more specifically on their community school. Because remarkably, of their 3 All-Ireland successes, 81, 85 and last year, no less than 2/3 of the team on each occasion was made up of former pupils of that community school.
Our catchment area is mainly the hurling catchment area of Offaly. And these boys came to the school, formed friendships in school, which surmounted all parish rivalries later. Now, it doesn't mean that there isn't parish rivalry still. There is. But the basic friendships that these lads formed in school far outweigh any of that over-intense rivalry that can sometimes emerge in hurling. And I think that has very much reflected itself in raising standards of hurling and in very deep friendships among players from different clubs.
Well, the team pictures around the walls of the school here bear testament to the kind of players that you've contributed to the Offaly jersey.
Oh yes, players of very high quality now. I was especially proud of the first half of this year's Leinster hurling final. I think it was a game of very, very high quality, and the standard of hurling in it was as good as I've ever seen.
When it's not always raining, there'll be days like this. When there's no one complaining, there'll be days like this. Everything falls into place like the flick of a switch. Well, my mama told me there'll be days like this. When you don't need to worry, there'll be days like this. When no one's in a hurry, there'll be days like this. When you don't get betrayed by that old Judas kiss. Well, my mama told me there'll be days like this. When you don't need an answer, there'll be days like this. When you don't need a chance, there'll be days like this. When all the parts of the puzzle start to look like they should, then I must remember there'll be days like this.
Johnny, sitting here in the classroom again, I'm sure it brings back a few memories. Bad for you.
Well, I suppose there are a whole pile of memories, not so much many in the classroom. Things have probably changed since I've been here. Di Regan is he's in the classroom for a change. Other things haven't changed. I'm still here at 6 o'clock and after hours in school. But yeah, there were good memories in the school. Probably Harlan were the good memories. Their leaving cert results would tell you.
Well, you were asking Brother Dennis earlier on if he had taught you maths in school. The fact you couldn't remember that says its own little story.
Well, I'd say the fact that Brother Dennis couldn't remember teaching me, I remember him quite well. The result was an E as well. But, yeah, Brother Dennis taught me maths for one long year.
Well, obviously, Dahi, I mean, the schooling was one aspect of this school. The hurling was another aspect altogether and very important to it all.
It was, yeah. The hurling was a huge aspect of it. I think for a long time, between the Presentation College and Borough Community School, they've been striving to make a breakthrough. And I think they've played in a couple of All-Ireland finals against North Mon and Flannans. When we made the breakthrough in 86, Pádraig Corn and Brother Dennis were very involved with us, Joe Kane in the school. And I think that was probably one of the highlights for all the guys who were involved in that team was to win the colleges, because we've been beaten the previous year. And I think also it was probably something Brother Dennis had longed for a long time as well, to make that breakthrough. So it was very good, yeah.
Well, Dahi and Johnny were here in sort of the mid-80s, I suppose. You left here in 1990, Kevin, so I suppose you were the young fellow of the three.
Yeah, that's right when I came, yeah, because this college, like, done bad, like, that year, like.
Mm-hmm.
Like, to me clean at Tahoe's, like, the hurling, like.
You didn't do as good a job as they've been done before.
No.
Well, you've obviously made up for it since.
Yeah,
just Dahi, looking back on some of those colleges matches and schools occasions, obviously the school distinguished themselves. I remember an occasion, 1986, in Port Leisha. You distinguished yourself as well in, an infamous final, in a way.
Yeah. I suppose the fact that we beat North Mumbai so much in that game, after being beaten the previous year in a replay, it was a huge boost for hurling and Offaly to beat a Cork team, a famed Cork team, by that much. So the last couple of minutes are probably best forgotten. Dennis might remind us. I think I was sent off with a couple of minutes to go, you know. But
as
I think all was
Jimmy McGee would say, you took an early shower that particular evening.
Took an early shower. I think all was forgotten about once we'd actually won. It was just a minor thing in the end of it.
I suppose playing for Offaly was like an extension of the school team in some ways.
It was, yeah. We started off in national school with the Borough lads, and when we came to the community school, we joined up with Kevin and Johnny Dooley, Billy Dooley and all them. We went on there from minors and on to under-21s and the seniors. I suppose the reason why we probably played together was to get out of the class, anyway, for the starters, you know. But it is definitely like an extension. We've grown up since 11, 12, all the way up.
Apart from Kevin Zero, which he admits wasn't as successful as what had gone before him, there's good hurlers and camogie players in the school at the moment as well.
There is, yeah. Unfortunately, they're not getting the results. The results aren't going their way. I suppose during our time that we were lucky that we had big men like Dottie Regan, and there was a few others around that could fight their way to the sideline. But the results aren't going our way over the last number of years since maybe that contingent have left the school. And hopefully between last year's All-Ireland and hopefully if the right result goes for us next Sunday, that it'll boost the school and bring it back to what was once a glory days.
I think school days are something you never forget. I know we walked around the school this evening, and you know, it's 9 years since I lived here, but even to walk around it still, it brings back a lot of memories. And I think it's where you learn your hurling from underage through the community school here, and it is very much an honour to come back as an All-Ireland medal winner here.
He's going for a goal, and he's got it! A goal of 3 points. That's exactly what Offaly require, and what the game has needed. So just 2 points between the teams. Look at the number of players they had back on the line defending. And straight between Kieran Carey and Dave Clark. Offaly now feeling that they can turn the tide. Pat O'Connor's in! It's another one! It's another goal! Pat O'Connor has got it! Offaly are in front by a point! Two goals in the space of a minute and only 4 minutes left. You never have an Offaly team beaten. They come from a very small area in County Offaly, the hurling districts, from an 8 mile radius around Burr. They have a great club atmosphere, so too Limerick. Joe O'Connor taking it away, as far as Dave Clark. Dispossessed by Billy Dooley, taken here by Brendan Kelly. Kelly playing it out to a loose man, who's Johnny Dooley. Is that a point? It certainly is. A goal and 4 points now all of a sudden for Johnny Dooley. Towards Frankie Carroll, beaten for it by Hubert Rigney. Comes back to Johnny Pokington, striving to take it up. Good vision, seeing that John Troy was free. Troy trying to tag on another point, but that's over. Yes, just seemed to have gone wide, but he had it perfectly, and there's a goal between them. John Troy's first point of the day. Triumphant fans up there on Hill 16. Ger Hegarty. Now suddenly it's Limerick who need a goal just to stay in it. Well, whoever said the match is never over until the final whistle. It was never truer than in this case here, as Billy Dooley fires in another beauty. A stage of the match when they can do absolutely nothing wrong. That's 3 points for Billy Dooley.
We had a lot of heavy training really done during the winter, and it's only a matter of trying to keep sharp now and trying to keep the mind focused. You know, it's a long 3 or 4 weeks from the semi-final to the final. It's just, you know, to keep your concentration for that time. That's the hardest part, but, you know, there's been no change in the trend. I think it's great credit to the lads, especially the board players, who had a long run with their club as well. And for them, you know, to come back straight into hard training again after a long run with their club, it was very difficult. But I think, you know, it's supposed to, as you said, we haven't won that much over the years, and we've won a few All-Irelands, and I think that kind of hunger is what keeps the team going, that, you know, we want to be remembered for winning a couple of All-Irelands, not just for winning one and being a one-hit wonder. So I think that's what keeps the team. And there's also a couple of players back in this year that weren't in last year, which adds a bit of spice. There's lads fighting for positions all the time. I think you need that as well to keep the competition going. It's lovely coming down to summer evenings, nice evenings like this, and training. You know, it makes up for all the hard training during the winter, and it's great to be back in another final.
After winning last year, there's great excitement, and it's something that you drive yourself to go maybe the whole way again and win another one, you know.
John, talk to me a little bit about your own form this year and how this summer has gone for you.
Well, at the start of the year, I was never as fit. I wasn't even fitter last year, and I hurt reasonably well against Wexford, but I picked up an injury against Wexford, and it has limited me training a good bit. And since the final, I got through it, and the down game, I didn't go well at all, you know, but hopefully there might be one big one in me, you never know.
Things have been going all right for us. We've hurled with each other a long time, you know, so we know each other very well. And as I said, like, things just seem to be going okay at the minute.
It'll be an interesting setup naturally in the final against Clare. They've proved themselves to be good at midfield and very, very pacey from the half-forward line.
Yeah, especially against Galway now, when Galway brought them back to 2 points there. You know, they just seemed to up it a gear and pulled away again from them. So they're playing at a very high level.
Are you satisfied that you're good enough again this year to win that title?
Who knows? It's a very hard to say what game, what way it's going to go, you know. It's a final and anything can happen.
I think back in the late 80s, there was a couple of us that ran the Leinster 3 in a row winning team. But most of the team were experienced and they were coming to retirement age. So it took a little while for the younger, like Johnny Dooley, Brian Whelan, I've just worked running 18, 19 that time, Hubert Rigney. So it took a while for them to come through, but I think now we have a balance. We have sort of between a 22, 23 to 27, 28, 12, 13 of the team at that age. And I think that's always the age you need to be going well in Leinster and All-Ireland Championships.
Pat Delaney goes up for it, and Pat Delaney grabs him. Pat going upfield now. 3 Galway men about to descend on him. Make that 4. In down to Brendan Birmingham. Birmingham inside to Flaherty. Flaherty is inside, and the ball is in there, and it's a goal. Offaly are in the lead. Johnny Flaherty putting Offaly into the lead.
Why have the hurlers been more successful?
Well, I think there was more of a hunger there. The footballers had one in the 70s, and the 81 was probably the tail end of an era in football, and whereas the hurlers was the beginning of an era, and we were hungrier for success, and we wanted more success. And the fact that we had witnessed so many bad times, I think, when I look back at my career, I never remember the victories. I can remember the sad times and the defeats and the heartbreaks and the scores that we missed more than anything else, and that's what keeps driving us on. And I'll always remember back to we came home in 1981 on the platform downtown. And I think this is where most of the present team started. Dermot Healy talked about the young people. He didn't talk about the senior team that won the All-Ireland. He talked about the young people that was on the stand, or just underneath those on the stand. And he talked about making sure that each one of those had a hurley and each one of those were coached. And he encouraged people to get involved. I think that's where this present team started, was from the young people of 1981.
Those must have been absolutely remarkable days around Offaly. It was something obviously entirely new for you all.
Yeah, well, we were just talking about it earlier here. I suppose the fervour is probably the same below in Clare at this stage. It's their first All-Ireland, and we can relate to that now in a big way, because at that time, like in 1980 and 81 in Offaly, like, just it was just unbelievable, the atmosphere around the county and the occasion afterwards then and the aftermath of the All-Ireland and everything.
I would have to say that the crowds in 85 were, if anything, no bigger than they were in 84, because everybody came out in 84 as well. And I've seen other counties come home having lost the All-Ireland finals, and maybe I often felt some counties didn't get the recognition they deserved for the performances they put in. And there's such a thin line between the two, you know, so that made 85 great.
John-
George Ryan then starting the second half, and Joachim Kelly taking a tap on the face but holding possession. Offaly playing from left to right for the second half. Remember, they're leading by 2 points. But very much thanks to that goal in the first half. Mark Corrigan through towards Brendan Birmingham, inside towards Pat Cleary, and he gets it! Pat Cleary has scored a second goal here in Croke Park. Cross towards Joe Dooley's wing, gets a second chance. Can he turn Kilkenny once more? He can. Fierce determination in his run. Inside for Mark Corrigan. A point. Oh, it's a blistering start to the second half. It's a real scramble for possession over there. John Murphy for Galway. Jerk Coughlin, it's anybody's game. It's there for the taking. Paul Corrigan says, I'll take this, and he takes a smashing point. Delighting the Offaly supporters.
As you know, next Sunday we have 15 of the panel which came through this school here. And over the years, we've also produced many of the minors and under-21s that have played for Offaly. We've been fortunate, I suppose, the fact that we live in the catchment area here in Offaly, and that the primary schools have done wonderful work over the years in this locality.
When I look back on it, Michael, I would love to be out there, but I do feel for the players in relation to the pressure that's on before the game. They're under extreme pressure, and they can't really enjoy it prior to the occasion. Me now as a supporter, I certainly can enjoy the game and I can look forward to it, as all the supporters do. But I know that the players, when the game is over, that they'll look back on the final, and they'll really enjoy the final when they look back on it, and they'll have the memories, as we do now, of the All-Ireland final.
Well, my mama told me there'll be days like this. Well, my mama told me there'll be days like this. Well, my mama told me there'll be days like this. Well, my mama told me there'll be days like this. Well, my mama told me there'll be days like this. Well, my mama told me there'll be days like this.
Of the present crop of students, you have one or two who are making their way through the ranks, if you like?
Absolutely. We had 7 or 8 again on the Offaly Minor Hurling team this year, and we hope to continue that. And it's one thing that I would hope that would emerge from the hype that surrounds an All-Ireland final appearance even, let alone a victory, that it has a huge spin-off on the young people in this area again, and it gives them figures and heroes to look up to, that they can emulate themselves.
Because of the number of players on given Offaly teams down through the years who've come from this school, I'm sure that it gives you a great sense of pride when you watch Offaly play.
Oh yes, I had a problem in 84, of course, when Offaly were playing my native county. But even then, I had to take it that the players that I was associated with would have been my first preference to win in All-Ireland, even against my native county.
So a Corkman with a big contribution to Offaly hurling. Another man who has made a huge impact in the fateful county is Eamon Cregan from Limerick. I caught up with him in the peaceful surroundings of Kinnity.
My philosophy, if that's what you call it, would go back to what my father would have felt the game, how the game should have been played. And that was simplicity, as Jim Hennessy and Waterford would say, a modiref, direct ball. And you get the ball and you move it, and you do no fancy stuff. Your objective is get the ball, move it to the forward as quickly as possible and as effectively as possible.
Looking back now, almost 12 months later, to winning that All-Ireland title for Offaly last year, how difficult was it? Because you were very emotional afterwards.
Very difficult. It was extremely difficult. I'm still emotional about it because you know the situation, Marty. You're there and you've been with Limerick for all your life, and your one ambition, and it was always my one ambition, was to win an All-Ireland with Limerick. And then you turn around and you're with a county that suddenly are playing Limerick in an All-Ireland final, and they beat Limerick. And like, as I said to you last year, I had a job to do, or we had a job to do, and we did it to the best of our ability. And now, 12 months later, it's a totally different atmosphere. You know, I've no allegiance to Clare as such. They're the county in an All-Ireland final. They're like any other county. They're like Kilkenny, they're like Wexford, they're like Tipperary. And I think I've got stronger from last year's experience.
Does it annoy you when people say that Offaly stole the All-Ireland title, that they just won it in 5 minutes?
It does, you know. I don't care. I remember playing a county final in 1972 or 1971 against South Liberties. And for 58 and a half minutes, we were behind. And in a minute and a half, we scored 2 goals and won the game by 2 points. And people say, ah, yeah, but Liberties deserve to win it. But, like, we won the county final. And at the end of the day, it's what's up on the scoreboard. And it doesn't matter how badly you play, but if you win, winning is the be-all and end-all of everything. Well, that some people may disagree with that, but I've heard people say we were the better team last year. They weren't the better team. At the end of the day, at the end of 70 minutes, Offaly were 7 points ahead. That dictates who is the better team. They may have played better hurling, but like when you play better hurling, you've got to put the scores up on the board. They didn't get the scores, and we were there at the end to come in and score. So, like, I don't know. It annoys me a little bit, yeah.
I remember last year watching it with 5 minutes to go, going around Croke Park pitch, talking to Offaly players as much as possible, running in, giving them a word of advice. What were you saying to them? And indeed, what was the reaction of the Limerick bench to your advice?
I don't know what the reaction of the Limerick bench was, but all I was doing with 5.5 minutes to go, I had the stopwatch, and I had gone up to Martin Hannemey. I said, Martin, there's 5.5 minutes left in it. You know, I said, come on, lift the game. Because, you know, it's 5.5 minutes to go, we were in deep trouble. And suddenly we got that free below at the other end. Now, fortunately, I wasn't down there because I would have told Johnny to go for a point because there was 5.5 minutes to go. And to Johnny's credit, he took the decision himself. Now, I don't think he hit it well, but it ended up in the back of the net and the rest is history.
Offaly now feeling that they can turn the tide. Pat O'Connor's in! It's another one! It's another goal! Pat O'Connor has got it! Offaly are in front!
Does it bother you what has happened to Limerick since? There's been disharmony in the camp in the earlier part, just after the All-Ireland. They've lost the Munster Championship.
Yeah, it always bothers me when Limerick lose, you know. There was a bit of disharmony there. I do feel that they deserve some trip abroad if it was only for a week, you know, because they had trained unbelievably 4 nights a week and lost in All-Ireland. And I think, okay, maybe somebody should have come along and said, okay, let's send you away for a week out of the country, just as a thank you for what they had done. Now, this year, I think they may have been a little bit confident. Now, I thought they played very well against Tipperary, and it was a great win. But I think they may have come into the Munster final a little bit cocky, saying, ah, we beat Clare last year by so much. We beat them again, no trouble this year. And then they were beaten, and this is the way they were beaten. Like, they seemed to be disheartened after a very short period of time, but I'm disappointed, and I think everybody in Limerick is disappointed, but, like, it's time to get the act together again now. There's another year ahead.
Before we leave the 94 All-Ireland final, you do a lot of walking around the pitch. You're almost like a 16th man. Do you take any notice of the amount of abuse that you get from the crowd?
Oh, yeah. You're so close that you'll always have the ignoramus that'll abuse you. And, like, there are times there in the games you get cheesed off of the whole lot, you know. And like, I'm not there to be abused by anybody on the sideline. And I think something similar happened to Babs Blow and Cork a few years ago, you know. Like, we're there to do the best for the team we're in charge of. And, like, you'll always get ignorant people anywhere. But it does, like, I remember going to a match with my wife and family and playing in a match. And the amount of abuse that I got playing in that particular match decided I wasn't going to play club hurling anymore. At that stage, anyway, I don't know what it was, 42 or 43. And it was an easy way out. But, like, my wife and children heard the abuse that was hurled at me. And, you know, they were 8, 9 and 10. And that affected them. So there are always ignorant people around in it. We're better off without them, but they'll always be there.
Eamon, obviously being manager of the Offaly hurling team is very time-consuming. Do you ever feel like quitting?
I do, yeah. It's very time-consuming. It takes approximately 5.5 to 6 hours from leaving Limerick, going to Tullamore, doing the session, coming back every night. Now, that means my golf has suffered. Again, I have to arrange my holidays around training sessions. I was lucky this year. I took a week where we had only one session during the week. Derry took the session. But it's very time consuming, and I'm very fortunate that Anne has been very receptive to that, you know.
Before the Wexford game, when I met you, you seemed to be very apprehensive. You felt that if Offaly were going to get caught this year, it was going to be then.
Yeah, well, I've great regard for Liam Griffin. I've known him for many years. He studied as a student in the Shannon's catering school or hotel management school in Shannon, and I'd known him then. And he's a successful businessman. So therefore, his success as business, he would have transferred it into the Wexford team. Now, there always comes a time when a team like Wexford suddenly strike a golden patch. And what I was afraid of is that they would strike it against us and we wouldn't be prepared for it. And that's why where the apprehension came in.
Johnny Dooley inside towards Patrick O'Connor. It's on for John Troy. And that's that. The All Ireland champions are certain now of a place in the Leinster final.
The Leinster hurling final of 1995 will be remembered for two things: your team performance against Kilkenny and, of course, the torrential downpour. Did the latter have any effect on the result, do you think?
I think it had a bearing on it, all right. But when you take into account the Kilkenny half-forward line of Delaney, Ronan, and left corner forward Byrne, he was only 20 years of age. Delaney and Ronan had been there before, but they were smaller men, you know. And it did have an effect that with the rain that we kind of physically blocked them from creating chances. But there was one situation, I've seen the tape a second time just to see how we played. There was one attempt at one stage where PJ Delaney passed the ball. And if it had gone to the Kilkenny forward that he had passed, he was hoping to reach, it could have been a different game. Because the game was gone hither and thither, and there was tremendous physical contact and tremendous skill at that particular time. But it had an effect, there's no doubt, but it also had an effect in our game. Then we came out in the second half and we got a very fortunate goal from Donoghue Regan. And from that minute onwards, we sort of got tremendous confidence and went forward from there.
Nice sidestep here by Donoghue Regan, steadying himself, drop low! By Brian Whelehan, back to his best this afternoon. Johnny Dooley avoided the block of Liam Cowan. Lobbed inside towards Pat O'Connor against Pat Dwyer. That's a brilliant goal!
Some critics would maintain, judging on your performance against Down in the All-Ireland semi-final, that there is at least a possibility that Offaly have peaked for the Kilkenny game.
Yeah, I was at Derry Donovan's 50th birthday party in Shannon Rugby Club there, about 2 months ago. Derry will love me for saying that now, but I met Colm Tucker, you know, who was a Munster rugby selector, and the first thing he said, have you peaked? You know, Jesse played very well against Wexford, against Kilkenny. Have you peaked? And can you come back and peak again? And that danger is always there. It's you've got to, like, you take Dublin. Dublin played tremendously well in the Leinster football final. They didn't play as well last Sunday, but still won. And, like, again, we've got to sort of gear ourselves to try and peak on our Ireland day. And it's a dicey thing to do. You know, you're planning, and you do so much training for this and so much for this and so much for this, and then get them right for the Ireland day. But what happens if you're knocked out in the first round? You're gearing yourself for an All-Ireland in September and you're knocked out in the first round and your plans have gone out the door. So I hope we haven't peaked against Kilkenny.
In the All-Ireland semi-final, Eamon, against Down, you seemed to start brilliantly. You'd won 6 up. And then after that, you seemed to just literally stutter along.
Yeah. We were afraid of what had happened to Offaly in 89, that they were playing reasonably well and coasting along. And suddenly Antrim got a goal in the second half and they lifted their game and they went ahead and won. And we were afraid of that our players would go up and they would approach the game in something similar and say, we've no trouble winning this game, you know. So we spoke to them, and as you know, they started off in tremendous style. They scored a goal and 6 points, and then suddenly they eased off. They took their foot off the accelerator, and they began to play badly. And I wasn't happy with their performance. Down came in, scored a goal, and at halftime I think we were only 5 or 6 points up. So I had to say a few words to them at halftime and get them going again in the second half. But it was a very unimpressive performance against Down.
Eamon, when you saw Clare play against Cork and Limerick, did you think then that they'd be your final opponents?
No. Oh, I'll be quite honest about it. I didn't think, first of all, that they'd beat Cork, because there's this Cork thing. I thought it would be a Cork-Tipperary Munster final this year, because, you know, Tip were all set to come back, and there were going to be a final, a huge input from them and from their older players. I thought Cork would just scrape it against Clare. But Clare went out against Cork, and then with about 15 minutes to go, they started to run at the Cork defence, and Cork hadn't anything. Against Limerick, they blew Limerick out of it. They went in against Galway then, and I said, if it's going to be a very tough match, because Galway and Clare are very close neighbours. They know each other's style of game. And what impressed me was about Clare was the fact that Galway came to within 2 points in the second half. And, OK, if a goal had gone in at that stage for Galway, then Clare were in serious trouble. But suddenly, PJ O'Connell got a ball, I think it was 80 yards out, and he let fly, and it lobbed on top of the net. And I remember then I said to myself, well, they're coming back now. And then suddenly they took on Galway and came back in and scored more and more. And that was the thing that impressed me about Clare. They're no longer willing to die. Mm. They now know that they'll keep going right to the end. And that would have a certain amount, fitness would have a lot to do with that. Plus, Gerlach Nan's input.
What's the greatest threat from this Clare team?
We're beaten at the end of the match. Their half-back line has gelled and blended together extremely well. Shawny McMahon is playing well. Doyle is a tremendous player, very underrated. Mm. And Anthony Daly has sorted out one or two little problems that he had. And he's now playing as an attacking half-back. Their centre-fields are very good. Brian Lawhon at full-back and Dave Fitzgerald is exceptional. They're exceptional players. And their forward work is a unit. And they fight and they play for each other. And it doesn't matter who scores as long as Clare scores.
Looking at the All-Ireland final and being honest and realistic, you will be favourites. You are favourites.
Oh, we are. There's no doubt about that. You were expecting me now to say we wouldn't be favourites.
Is that a disadvantage?
It can be. But remember this, 31 counties are cheering for Clare. And that's the other side. The sympathy will be with Clare. We're favourites, but Clare have all the sympathy. And that, to me, balances itself out. Because we are now we are against the rest, and everybody wants Clare to win.